Thank you so much for taking time out of your busy lives to participate in this critical and ongoing discussion about the threats that our animal friends face under the new administration and how we can all continue to be passionate advocates for them. My name is Michelle Alvarez, and I'm the Outreach Manager at Catskill Animal Sanctuary. CAS is a 120-acre haven in New York's Hudson Valley. We do emergency rescue of horses and farm animals from cruelty, neglect, and other desperate situations. In addition to emergency rescue, CAS also champions vegan living through a variety of innovative educational programs. I won't take up too much of your time, but now before I introduce our esteemed moderator and panelists, I just want to thank some folks who were instrumental in making tonight happen. I want to thank NYU Law School, and in particular the NYU Student Animal Legal Defense Fund, especially Amanda Drennan and Alexander Katz. I also want to thank the NYU Animal Welfare Collective, most notably Anami Nguyen. And our food and beverage sponsors. I hope you all enjoyed the food and the juices. So the pizza was provided by Screamer's Pizza, and the other, the mac and cheese, as well as the little cups of treats were provided by Freakin' Vegan, and then the juice came from Juice Generation. So without further delay, thank you all for your patience tonight. I'd like to introduce our moderator, who is Kathy Stevens. She is the founder and director, executive director of Catskill Animal Sanctuary. Now, her love of animals was instilled during her childhood when she counted as her friends many goats, horses, and a donkey named Linda. After moving to Boston to pursue her graduate degree, she taught high school English until 1999 when she was offered the principalship of a new high school. Instead, she co-founded Catskill Animal Sanctuary, where her love of teaching and her belief that education has the power to transform and her love of animals come together. To date, CAS has saved over 4,000 farm animals through direct rescue and exponentially more through groundbreaking programming that encourages humans to adopt a plant-based lifestyle. Kathy has also written two books about the work of Catskill Animal Sanctuary and takes our message of kindness to all beings to conferences and colleges in the US and Canada. She lives on the grounds of CAS with her pit bull Chumley and her black lab Scout and kisses many critters every single day. Okay, so our first panelist is Valerie Barron. She is an Equal Justice Works Law Fellow sponsored by the Animal Welfare Trust at the Natural Resources Defense Council in Washington, D.C. In the Health and Food and Agriculture programs, she defends environmental and health laws, campaigns to change our food system, and represents communities in litigation. She focuses primarily on NRDC's climate healthy menus and factory farm accountability initiatives. Previous to NRDC, she was of counsel to Friends of the Sea Otter, an attorney with the Environmental Integrity Project, and Democratic staff to the Committee on Energy and Commerce at the House of Representatives. Paul Shapiro is Vice President of Policy at the Humane Society of the United States, where he promotes policies that advance animals' interests across all 50 states. From 2005 to 2016, Paul led HSUS's farm animal protection efforts, where he played an integral role in legislative and corporate campaigns to improve the plight of farm animals. Paul also founded Compassion Over Killing in 1995 and served as its campaigns director until 2005. While there, he worked as a farm animal cruelty investigator and led initiatives to end misleading advertising on factory farm products. Adam Weissman is the founder of Global Justice for Animals and the Environment, an organization addressing the threat posed by free trade agreements to animals, the environment, sustainable food, and environmental defenders. He also represents GJAE in Trade Justice New York Metro, which is a coalition of local organizations from diverse social movements working together to resist the NAFTA model of trade deals for the 1%. As coordinator of Trade Justice Alliance, he supports fair trade activists with resources including webinars, e-newsletters, and the Trade Justice website. So, without further delay, should we get started?
Yes.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Thanks again to everybody, and I'm just going to get right down to it because we've been waiting a long time. The format, 3-minute opening statements. I got my little stopwatch. I'm going to hold you to it. Get your best stuff ready. 3 simple questions to the panelists so we can take a deep dive and not be overwhelmed, because I think that's one thing all of us are feeling. An open discussion at the end of those 3 questions, just between the 4 of us. I've got my notebook ready to take notes. And then a 20 to 30 minute Q&A. We have learned from NYU that we can go a little over if we need to. So thanks for being here. And who wants to go first? Okay, we'll just start with Paul and go this way.
Sure.
Paul, you got 3 minutes.
Well, thank you, Kathy. And I just want to say first, give a round of applause for Michelle, since she didn't get one when she came up. So give it up, Michelle. We're very grateful to you for helping to organize this event, Michelle. And we are all, especially myself, so grateful not only for the great work that Catskill Animal Sanctuary does, but for bringing us all here together tonight. It's awesome to see such a big group of people who want to do what we can to resist the onslaught of activity that's going on against animals right now. So I want to say thank you to Kathy, and I've brought you a gift, Kathy. This is a little plug for a new book from HSUS author Eddie Garza. Salud, the first vegan Mexican cookbook ever out, hot off the press. It's burning my fingers, it's so hot.
Yes, I needed this cookbook.
Yes.
Thank you.
I figured that she didn't know how to make vegan food, so.
I know, struggle with it.
So thank you. And Christy Middleton has a new book out. Speaking of HSU authors, her new book is out this week called Meat Less. If you haven't gotten it, pick it up. It's really awesome. So my name is Paul Shapiro, and I work for the Humane Society of the United States to protect animals by advancing policies that will protect their interests and by trying to defeat bad policy proposals that will harm their interests. So let me ask you a quick question. That would basically be to envision this scenario. Imagine on a cold winter night in Alaska, a mother wolf is sleeping in her den trying to protect her pups from the Alaskan chill. They hear some feet rustling, and men with night vision goggles come in, and before the wolf family can even get up on its feet, they're shot at point blank range and killed. Or think about the next day as a family of grizzly bears is ambling across the Alaskan tundra. And the mother is thinking about her 2 cubs who are following her. And then they hear the buzz of a low-flying plane's propellers. They look up, and the plane quickly lands next to them. And out jumps a hunter and shoots the family again at point-blank range. These perilous, dangerous, inhumane hunting methods are on the verge of becoming legal in Alaska's national wildlife refuges. Refuges. The Obama administration's Fish and Wildlife Service put forth a rule that it finalized, which prohibited such barbaric hunting methods on the 77 million acres, more than half of Alaska's landmass, bigger than the entire state of New Mexico. And just last month, the House of Representatives, on a nearly party line vote, voted to undo that rule for the Alaska Wildlife Refuge System. 10 brave Republicans broke ranks and voted against it, yet it still passed. And now that bill is pending in the Senate. It's called SJ Res 18. And if that bill passes, there's almost no chance that President Trump wouldn't sign it. And so we think about not only the damage that that will do to animals on Alaska's wildlife refuges, but also think about the fact that by going the way they're going through what's called the Congressional Review Act, it would prohibit the Fish and Wildlife Service in perpetuity from ever, even under a future administration, re-implementing a same or even similar rule. That is one example of what is at stake right now in the new Congress and with the new administration for animals. And we're talking about a lot more things just like this, but it is literally a life and death situation for large numbers of animals. And I'm really, really looking forward to all of us talking here tonight about what we can do to stop that type of barbarity from becoming a reality on the land that us as federal taxpayers own. Thank you.
Thanks, Paul.
Sorry. I would like to thank Paul because I got to watch the room as everyone's faces started like this with a Mexican food cookbook. And then over the course of Paul's 3 minutes, everybody just sort of, all of your faces fell. And I now am inheriting this super depressed room. So I don't have a thank you gift, but yeah, you have my sincere gratitude. So, we're going to try and keep it light, but I think we all do have a sense of what's at stake here. For us as people, for our animal friends, and for the society in which we live. And a big theme of my remarks tonight, and something that I would like to encourage us all to keep in mind, is I think in our guts we all know what we have to do. We have to do what we can to stay ourselves, to keep fighting this fight for the long haul. And so while our faces are going to fall, every time Paul speaks, I assume, I'm going to keep giving you a hard time. Let's just try and keep in mind what is at stake here, but also that Americans didn't vote for dirty air, dirty water, and animal abuse. And the truth is on our side, the facts are on our side, and while this administration has waged and is continuing to wage an assault on truth and fact and science, which is what I'm going to talk to you about, we can keep highlighting those things and the facts will bear out. So when Michelle read my bio, there were a lot of nouns in there. What is a law fellow sponsored by an animal welfare trust in a food and health program at an environmental organization doing on a panel about Trump and the environment? So there are 9 billion animals in this country, and does anybody know where they live? What kind of farms? Which are not what most people, I mean, you all know this, it's not what most people picture when they close their eyes and picture a farm. And by and large, animal welfare laws don't do much, if anything, to protect those animals. And so as a community of advocates, we have relied on the safeguard system that is our regulatory system, and typically environmental laws to advance welfare and transparency for those animals. And that system is now under attack in a very extreme way that's being portrayed as rollbacks or reforms and normal, but it's anything other than normal. And so today, when we get into the depths of our conversation, I want to talk to you about this system of safeguards, the regulatory attacks, the potential legislative attacks, and Paul also hit the nail on the head there, things that previously, you know, we had to keep an eye on. Now there's really just a very thin layer between what somebody on the fringe might propose and what could be signed into law, so we have to keep an eye there. And then going forward, we really have to focus on enforcement, law enforcement of these common sense safeguards, and just keep in mind that nobody voted for animal abuse and keep highlighting that. So that's what we'll talk about tonight.
Oh, so I'm going to be...
I'm sorry.
While Adam is getting set up, I think there's some more seats, Sharon, over on that side if you want to go that way. And anybody else who's standing up, we got some empty seats this way. All right. You get your exercise in. You're standing desk back there. Cool.
Okay, great. Okay, great. So, proving the rule about a stopped clock, Donald Trump, on his first Monday in office, signed an executive order pulling the U.S. out of the Trans-Pacific Partnership Free Trade Agreement, TPP. This was very bad news for big meat. The U.S. International Trade Commission had reported that pork, dairy, chicken, and beef were going to be the biggest winners of this trade agreement, with hundreds of millions in increased annual exports as a direct result. U.S. meat industry and dairy industry groups were direct advisors to the U.S. negotiating team and heavily lobbied in support of this agreement. Free trade agreements are critical to the U.S. agribusiness's strategy for expansion. Agribusiness has for decades benefited from subsidized livestock feed in tandem with the economy of scale facilitated by factory farming, low-cost animal products in high volume, and that has facilitated the U.S. moving to the top of the pack in terms of countries with the highest rate of animal product consumption. But U.S. animal product consumption is peaking. It's dropped a little bit there. It's now more plateauing, but it's not going up again. U.S. consumers are eating as many animal products as they're going to eat. The same is true of dairy. And the reality is U.S. agribusiness needs to find new markets. They're looking globally, looking at countries that have lower rates of animal product consumption, but higher rates of increase in consumption of animal products. Countries like China, regions like Latin America and Southeast Asia. Global meat production is going way up, and U.S. animal agribusiness wants and already has a big piece of that pie. Free trade agreements are a critical tool for expanding their market access towards that end by eliminating tariffs, quotas, stringent inspection rules, food safety standards, and ultimately potentially animal welfare requirements. Some of the tools that they use is what is euphemistically called harmonization of food safety standards, creating one flat, low standard across the board for all the participating countries in a trade agreement. State-to-state challenges at the World Trade Organization. When Europe banned imports of bovine growth hormone treated beef, the U.S. Challenged that successfully at the World Trade Organization, and the EU was forced to pay trade concessions as a result. Investor state dispute settlements, where corporations are empowered to sue governments in international tribunals when a corporation feels that an animal protection or food safety rule interferes with their future profits. Procurement rules built into trade agreements that could prohibit government selective purchasing. If, for example, the state of New York tried to require cage-free eggs or have humane certification on state-purchased meat products, that could be challenged. Ultimately, free trade agreements are facilitating a race to the bottom. Lower regulatory standards, cheaper animal products, and ultimately higher levels of consumption. And this has been a windfall for the meat industry. Trade agreement after trade agreement has increased their profit margins and increased their volume of consumption. You can see that the countries where the U.S. currently has trade agreements are largely, though not entirely, centered in Latin America. The Trans-Pacific Partnership was intended in part to fix that. Some of those key Southeast Asian countries that are a big part of that expansion in animal products were included in the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And China, the biggest potential market of all, was waiting in the wings. TPP was designed as a docking agreement that could add more countries after the fact. So the concept was for the U.S. to first set the rules with 11 other countries and then add China after the fact. So the meat industry, now that TPP for the U.S. is largely off the table, has two major objectives going into the Trump administration. One of them is to pursue their TPP objectives in smaller pieces. Trump has said that he wants to pursue bilateral trade agreements, meaning one country at a time, not big multilateral trade agreements like plurilateral trade agreements like TPP. And so they want to get the same gains that they were going to get through TPP, one agreement at a time. And the other thing they want to do is, because Trump has said that he wants to go back and renegotiate U.S. trade deals, they want to protect the gains that they already have in trade agreements, trying to make sure that further trade negotiations will not undermine the good deal that they already have going. And I'll be talking about more of the specifics during the questions. Thanks.
Really interesting perspectives up here, and we're going to ask three questions of everybody. What do you see to date that is of greatest concern? Based on what we have seen today, what is likely to come down the pike that we should be most aware of? And most importantly, as we are all feeling, many of us are feeling frightened and angry and confused and overwhelmed and disempowered. What can we, as individuals committed to having this country be kind and care for its most vulnerable, what can we in this room do? So that's it. And I'm going to turn off this little stopwatch and just say that each of you will have ballpark 5 minutes with each of those questions. And do we want to go now in reverse order, or do you want to break, Adam?
I wouldn't mind break, but I'm fine. Right.
Okay. We'll go with Valerie. We'll go with Valerie.
Sure.
Okay, so Valerie,
yes.
From your vantage point, what actions to date by the Trump administration, whether appointments or policy reversals or executive orders or appointments or something else, are cause for the greatest concern from
yes.
your vantage point?
Yes. Yes is the answer. now it's my turn to be a little depressing. Well, no, I previewed my answer to these questions. Can you hear me? I previewed my answer to these questions in my introduction. We are, one of the things and one of the reasons that we are all feeling so overwhelmed is it is a full-scale attack that goes deeper and broader than what we've seen before. And if we want to start with, you know, environmental and health safeguards, attacks on those are bad for animals as well. The system that for decades has provided these critical safeguards is under attack. And the attacks are coming in the form of attacks on science, data, and transparency. And one of the things that we can look to there are some of the actions that the administration has taken in the very, very early days. I'm sure that Paul will speak to this, and I know the Humane Society is litigating this, but there, many of you may have seen that the administration took down animal welfare data from their website. And that goes to what I was saying earlier. Nobody voted for animal abuse, and one of the strategies to promote this industry that does abuse animals is to hide it. And they've been able, Humane Society and some of their allies have been able to push back on that successfully, but we're seeing those kinds of attacks across agencies and across the government. There's something that's known as the Secret Science Bill that's getting processed through the House. It would change the science on which EPA can rely in its decision making. It would allow the inclusion of scientists with conflicts of interest on science advisory panels. And so what that means there is scientists that have industry conflicts of interest. It would water down the expertise of the panels, deliberately including non-experts, and exclude non-industry side experts receiving grants from EPA. So there are bills like this that really just in a very wonky way that seems very behind the scenes that can be described as a rollback or reform are really a very extreme attack on fact and truth and science. Another across the board attack that we're seeing underway right now is the RAA. It's a bill that we've been dubbing the Reject Accountability Act. That's not what the Republicans in Congress are calling it. It really is a nightmare. It's designed to take a sledgehammer to the regulatory system, make it harder or next to impossible to set regulations that protect the public by tilting scales in the favor of industry. And that has implications for human health, but tilting the scales in the favor of industry also can be a disaster for animals. One of the provisions in it would require agencies make rules, it would require them to pick the least costly rule. How many of you have ever been to a store or gone online to buy something and found something that is cheaper but made a decision to buy something else? Show of hands. Some of you, I think, maybe should be raising your hands. No, pretty much everybody raises their hands, right? Why would you buy something other than the cheapest thing? Because it offers you something more. Maybe it's better quality. It might be a better bargain. Often the cheapest thing is not the best bargain. But what this bill would do is it would require agencies to pick just the least costly rule. It would allow courts to substitute their judgment for that of expert agencies, and it would allow industry to use legal challenges to hold up new rules for ages and ages and ages. So, again, bringing this back to animals, what does that mean? You know, we in the animal advocacy community are used to being in a more defensive posture. There's a dearth of excellent rules out there to protect animals, right? But what this means is that it would give industry even more opportunities to go on the offense and to create rules that hide the facts, hide what's going on, and that can be a real disaster for animals on factory farms. I do want to speak to appointments, because I think that the appointment of Scott Pruitt to EPA is something that we cannot underscore enough how bad that is, both for the agency and for animals. He was the Attorney General of Oklahoma, and when he was there, he made the best of friends with the poultry industry. His predecessor, Drew Edmondson, had really made a name for himself in holding poultry operations accountable in a number of ways, and in wonderful ways, for the pollution that they caused and some of their practices. And Mr. Pruitt came in, and he had accepted something like $40,000 from the folks that his predecessor was suing in campaign contributions. And we don't know what was in his heart when he accepted them, but we do know what he did when he got into office. He immediately stopped filing anything. You know, for more than 6 years, he filed absolutely nothing in litigation against the poultry industry. He said he was renegotiating an agreement that Drew Edmondson had signed over poultry pollution, but what he did was he let the clock run out on an agreement that his predecessor had negotiated over poultry waste, and then he renegotiated it to make it weaker, buying the polluters extra time and extra ability to maintain their practices, overcrowding as is. So now we know that the animal agriculture industry has a really close friend at EPA, and that's something that we are all going to have to keep our eyes on really closely. So those are just a couple of examples of things that I think we need to be watching.
Yeah, super helpful. Paul.
Thank you, Kathy. The list of very dangerous and deadly to animals transgressions that have occurred so far is too numerous to enumerate in 5 minutes, but I do want to address a few of the key things that have happened and why they are so important. So Val mentioned this animal welfare blackout data, and you may be thinking, well, on principle, that's bad because we want transparency. Now, for those of you who aren't familiar, the APHIS, Animal Plant Health Inspection Service, part of USDA, used to have all of the violations for zoos, circuses, animal experimentation facilities, puppy mills, and so on, online. And when the new administration took over, the person leading the USDA transition team was a gentleman by the name of Brian Klippenstein. Brian's previous career was being the executive director of a group called Protect the Harvest, which its sole purpose is to attack HSUS. In fact, the single funder of it, a mega millionaire named Forrest Lucas, said that he wants his legacy in life to be remembered as the guy who defeated HSUS. This is the guy, Forrest Lucas. Have you ever heard of Lucas Oil from NASCAR, Lucas Stadium, where the Colts play? That's named after him. So Brian Klippenstein gets appointed to be the head of the transition team at USDA, and lo and behold, all these documents come down. And you're thinking, well, that's bad, right? We want transparency, but it's more than just bad. It's more than just non-transparent, because there are lots of laws, including here in New York City and in my own home state of Maryland, that say if you're a pet store, you cannot sell puppies that come from facilities that have Animal Welfare Act violations. Well, how do you know whether they have Animal Welfare Act violations if the database that's been online for years is no longer online? So it basically, it doesn't nullify these laws, but it mutes them so that you cannot enforce them because you just can't find out whether they're selling puppies from places that have had violations or not. So that's big problem number one. Another big problem is that the Obama administration finalized a rule that prohibits the soaring of Tennessee walking horses. This is a very inhumane practice where if you ever see these horses and these horse shows, they have them across the country, but it originated in Tennessee where the horses have a very extreme gait and they go like this. They're doing that because they're in pain, and they're in pain because they soar them. They torture the horses for weeks or months on end, and then they walk in this way that presents an opportunity for these guys to get a ribbon, basically, to have the biggest gait. And the Obama administration, because the Congress refused to pass what's called the PAST Act, Prevent All Soaring Tactics Act, the Obama administration's USDA finalized this rule that would basically take care of about 95% of the problem of horse soaring in the country. I mean, this is so rare that you get one rule in one fell swoop that has such a dramatic impact on a major national problem of animal cruelty. And unfortunately, while the Obama administration promulgated it, USDA put it on its website. For it to have the force of law, it needs to be published in the Federal Register. But the Federal Register, through a bureaucratic bungling, didn't publish it on the final day of the administration. And it should have been published then the next day, January 20th, but they don't publish on Inauguration Day. And when Trump got in, they issued a freeze on all pending rules. So even though this wasn't even technically pending, it's gotten caught up. And so it's not nullified, but it is on freeze while the new administration reviews it. Another rule that they did finalize and was in the Federal Register is an upgrade on the organic animal welfare standards. So a lot of the times when people see organic animal products like eggs or dairy or meat, they think that there are much higher animal welfare standards associated with it. And sometimes they're quite shocked to learn that organic really does not have much to do with animal welfare. It's not that it has nothing to do with it, but it has very little to do with it in most cases. Well, the Obama administration finalized a rule that dramatically upgrades the standards of care for animals in the National Organic Program, especially for egg-laying chickens. Hmm. The egg-laying chicken standard is much stronger than the previous rule. And part of it was for what Adam was talking about with harmonization, because we wanted to sell our eggs to Canada, and so they had much higher standards. We want our eggs to be labeled organic there. And so you had a case where our desire to sell our eggs in another market made us increase our animal welfare standards. Well, the Trump administration has now put that on a 60-day review because, of course, the egg producers are very displeased with this new rule. And so they're now reviewing that to see what they're going to do. Another rule, the Fish and Wildlife Service under Obama basically mandated a phase out of lead shot ammunition on national wildlife refuges. You may be shocked to learn that you can hunt at all on these refuges, but they put lead shot. Now keep in mind, we've gotten lead out of paint, we've gotten lead out of pencils, but lead is still the predominant method of ammunition production in our country. And that means that the animals who are killed by the hunter are not the only animals killed, because they fall to the ground and then scavengers, including bald eagles, yes, they're scavengers, vultures and other animals come and eat the carcass of the animal who was shot and die. Literally, this one rule preventing lead shot ammo in national refuges would have saved millions of non-target animals from perishing when they eat the carcasses. And when Ryan Zinke, the new head of our Interior Department, came to work last week, his very first day, he transported himself to work on a horse. He came on a horse, got off, walked into the department, and his very first act was to repeal this rule. Very first act. No consultation, no deliberation, completely repealed. So these are a few of the things that we are talking about when we're looking at what the stakes are. Some of them are congressional, like the thing I mentioned in the beginning about Alaskan National Wildlife Refuges. Some of them are through executive actions, like these that we're talking about, and some of them are through appointments, like Zinke, like Pruitt, like Brian Klippenstein at USDA. And so I'm eager, though, to talk about not just the doom and gloom of the perilous predicament that animals find themselves in now under this new administration and under the new Congress, but what we can all do to help animals survive this administration.
We're gonna get to that.
Yes, yes, that's the teaser for the, that's the cliffhanger
well
for
done,
the next
Paul.
Thing, yes. To be continued.
Okay.
What you got for us, Adam?
Okay, so last week, coming in right under the deadline, the Trump administration published the Office of the U.S. Trade Representative published their annual report and their principles and objectives for the Trump administration's trade policy. It's actually kind of comical because they started out by saying, well, we don't actually have a U.S. trade representative because he hasn't been approved yet. That's a whole story. So it's kind of hard to do this. But it was really pretty vague. But there was some very troubling language in these six. There are only six pages that actually deal with what Trump wants to do, and then hundreds of pages of what they did last year. In those six pages, there are some. They break down the bullet point. There's no specifics, basically, but they break down bullet points of some of their objectives, the Trump administration's trade objectives. One of them is break down unfair trade barriers in other markets that block U.S. exports, including exports of agricultural goods. In other words, global market access for corporate agribusiness. It also includes strongly advocating for all U.S. workers, farmers, ranchers, service providers, and businesses, large and small. So this was seen as a big fig leaf to ag interests who were worried that Trump's agenda about bringing back manufacturing jobs was going to leave agribusiness in the lurch, and in fact sending a message that in fact Trump was going to prioritize increasing market access for the factory farm for the nation's factory farm interests. what isn't meant by what, by the way, were never mentioned in those rules, by the way, in those principles, not a word about trade agreements, including strong environmental rules, not a word about conservation measures, certainly not a word about animal welfare rules. Now, the Obama administration at least had the courtesy to lie about those things. The Obama trade agreements were actually a step backwards in terms of all those things from the Bush administration in many regards. The Bush administration, compromising with Democrats, actually built 7 multilateral environmental agreements into trade negotiations. Obama only built one, but he at least span it. Trump, I guess for his constituency, doesn't even need to bother to do that. Another particularly disturbing thing. So one good thing that was in that report actually was, and that is just a general vibe that's been coming from the Trump administration of late, is that they are saying that they do not feel obligated to abide by World Trade Organization rulings that go against U.S. interests. Well, on a certain level, that actually sounds like a good thing, because animals have been repeatedly screwed by the World Trade Organization. The World Trade Organization, many of you may have seen from the Seattle WTO protest, the pictures of people in sea turtle suits. That was because of a World Trade Organization case where the U.S. was sued for requiring that shrimp sold in the requiring turtle excluder devices be used for U.S. sold shrimp. There's a successful WTO case brought by Mexico against the dolphin safe tuna rule. When the European Union tried to ban fur from countries where wild caught fur from countries where the leg hole trap is still legal, Canada and the U.S. threatened to challenge that, and the ban just evaporated just by the threat of a challenge. So pushing back on the WTO is a nice thing in theory, but President Trump kind of gave us an indication that we wouldn't actually see that kind of protection for animal or environmental rules under NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement, which, unlike the WTO, directly allows corporations. At the WTO, a country can sue another country. Under NAFTA, a corporation can sue a country. One example of that, when President Obama blocked the disastrous Keystone XL pipeline, the corporation behind that pipeline, TransCanada, brought a $15 billion suit under the North American Free Trade Agreement. This was a great opportunity for President Trump to say, I stand for sovereignty. I stand for protecting the right of the U.S. to make our own laws and not have our regulatory ability chilled by international tribunals but instead, President Trump reversed President Obama's ban, and as a result, TransCanada dropped their ban, sending a clear message that the Trump administration is not going to stand up to these attacks on U.S. sovereignty when they involve protecting the environment, when they're in opposition to projects like the Keystone XL pipeline, which facilitate the disastrous Athabasca tar sands project, which is turning boreal forest into forever destroyed habitats, poisoning wildlife, the tailing ponds that ducks fly into and die just from the toxicity, just absolutely horrific project. So the Trump administration, essentially, their strategy for trade competitiveness is eliminating U.S. regulations to the greatest degree possible to make the U.S. More competitive with other countries by having the lowest regulations, the lowest environmental rules, the lowest food safety standards, the lowest animal welfare standards, and that in Trump's mind is winning. That's what America First looks like. We could be trying to expand market access by doing what Paul is talking about, by actually harmonizing in the other direction. That's called upward harmonization. That's where we say, let's have common standards and let's make them good common standards, strong environmental rules, strong animal protection standards. But instead, Trump basically wants to bring the race to the bottom home. So I guess I'll stop there for now.
This is a cheery conversation. Okay, so the second question was going to be, but I might alter this a bit based on what we've been hearing. The question was going to be, again, through your lens, what actions by the administration are likely to be coming down the pike. But I also want to offer you the opportunity. One thing I've been waiting to see, and I'm sure many of you have, is you know, sort of guessing. There are all these actions that he intends to take, but we don't yet know what the Republicans are going to do. And yet, I don't love how few people are coming out against him. So whether it's, you know, whether it's self-serving or what have you. So either address what's likely to come down the pike, or what do you think, from your vantage point, what do you think we can expect of the Republicans? Who are our best hopes? Just take one of those questions.
Sure. Well, we can look at the votes already and see who our best hopes are. So as an example, if you look at Scott Pruitt's nomination for EPA, one Republican, Susan Collins of Maine, voted against him. That's a great sign that maybe she will also vote against opening up the Alaskan wildlife refuges to these types of inhumane slaughters. There's a very good book just on this topic that is actually authored by a person in this audience called The Trump Survival Guide by Gene Stone in the back. Give it up for my man, Gene. Yeah, he's got it here. He's signing autographs.
I just heard you interviewed the other day. I think I just heard you interviewed the other day on WAMC.
Yes.
Yes, sirree. I've been looking for your book.
Well, it's in the back. So you should read The Trump Survival Guide by Gene Stone, and I'm sure he'd be eager to talk with you about it in the back. But he talks about this, is who are the Republicans who we can try to peel off? Look, the Republicans control Congress and the White House and most of the state legislatures. We are not going to win by appealing only to Democrats. It may feel comfortable for people in this room to do that, or people living in New York City to do that, but the fact of the matter is that without Republicans, we will lose. There's no getting around it. And so 10 Republicans voted against opening up Alaska's refuges. Susan Collins voted against Scott Pruitt. We need to figure out how to peel off others. People, for example, maybe like Lindsey Graham, or John McCain, or even Jeff Flake. These are people who have, in some cases, been never Trumpers, or in other cases, they have been attacked by Trump, like Rand Paul, for example. And you think about what we can do to help them. So if you know people in Arizona, or Maine, or South Carolina, which are the states of the senators I just mentioned, we want to talk to them about contacting their senators to help them fight, because many of those Republicans are not anti-animal. A lot of them are pro-NRA, and look, it's difficult for them to go against the NRA, but sometimes they might be able to prevent bad things from coming up for a vote. They want to get that 100 on the NRA or in the Farm Bureau scorecards, don't get me wrong. But if they can avoid getting a vote on some of these issues, they would like to do that in many cases, because many of them aren't anti-animal. I mean, I know them. I know that a lot of these Republicans are not anti-animal at all. In fact, Susan Collins has 100% on the Humane Scorecard. And so you look at this and you realize, like, we need to reach across that aisle and bring some of them on. And importantly, we also need to make sure that the Democrats know that animal welfare is not something that they can ignore. The problem is for us is that, you know, you look at all of the nominees, the only one so far who has gone down has been on labor. On Andy Poster, because the labor movement is very, very connected to the Democratic leadership. Well, guess what? Your Senator Chuck Schumer runs the Senate Democrats. And he is somebody who the animal movement ought to be constantly lobbying to say, stand up when animals are under attack. Yes, it's important to be fighting on healthcare. Yes, it's important to be fighting for labor. And it's also important to be fighting for animals. So one of the things that I think we need to be extremely concerned about coming down the pike, to directly answer your question, Kathy, is if you think about a Republican like Susan Collins, 100% on our scorecard, go to the other end of the spectrum and think about someone like Steve King of Iowa. So Steve King represents the largest egg production district in America, in northwestern Ohio, Iowa. And he is the author of an infamous amendment called the King Amendment. And he first introduced it to the 2014 Farm Bill and got it included in the House version of the bill, and it never made it in the Senate version, and so it didn't become law. He then introduced it as a freestanding bill in the next Congress called the Interstate Commerce Protection Act. And here's what the so-called King Amendment would do. Basically, it would nullify what I've done with my life for the last 12 years. So a little bit of a parochial interest in this. But think about this. States like Massachusetts and California and some others have said, if you want to sell animal products in our state, like eggs or veal or pork, you need to adhere to these standards. And it's the same thing when California said, if you want to sell cars in our state, you have to have a certain mileage per gallon. They're saying, if you want to sell eggs in our state, you have to provide this level of animal welfare. And the King Amendment would say, no state can do that. It would nullify all state laws regulating the sale of agricultural products that might have emanated from another state. Instead of having a race to the top, it's just like Adam pointed out earlier, this would be a race to the bottom, where the state with the lowest animal welfare standard could dictate what every other state has to allow in the commerce of its products. This would almost certainly also affect puppy mills and pet stores, because oftentimes puppy mills are considered agricultural. This would almost certainly affect a whole host of other agricultural products, including, interestingly enough, tobacco, because as an agricultural product, many states require that cigarettes be produced in a fire-safe manner. When you throw them on the ground, they're less likely to cause a fire, and that would nullify even those laws. Hmm. Now, interestingly enough, Steve King has tried and failed twice, but he's newly emboldened. You know why? During the Trump campaign, a memo was leaked from the Trump agricultural talking points. What are the 10 top agricultural talking points of the Trump campaign? Number 6, passage of the King Amendment. So we're now looking at not only a House that has already passed this and has gotten worse, and an emboldened Senate, but a president who, at least in theory, has endorsed this specific proposal. That's the type of thing that is a really existential threat to animal protection laws across the country, and that we need to be extremely concerned about. Now, King could introduce it as a freestanding bill. I don't think he has a high chance of passing that, but you can rest assured that he will be introducing it when we have a farm bill debate. They're already starting to discuss the farm bill. It's scheduled to be done next year, but already the hearings have begun on it across the country. And so by telling Chuck Schumer, no King Amendment. Now, of course, Schumer already opposes the King Amendment, but as with everything, when you're dealing with leadership, you need to make sure it rises to the level of importance that there's a cacophony of protest against it, in the same way the Tea Party was organized against the Affordable Care Act at that time. We need to be organized in the interests of animals.
Thank you, Paul. Horrifying. Valerie?
Yeah.
Either question.
Could I address both?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Thank you, Paul. I think those were very insightful comments, and there's a lot in there that really resonates very strongly with me. And one of the themes, and this is my natural perspective, being at an environmental organization on a panel like this, is that we do have to look to some of the sources of power that Paul talked about, but we also have to look across issue areas at this intersectionality between, like you were mentioning, the California cars example is a really great example of something that is a theme in the Republican attacks and the leadership attacks on regulation and on safeguards that will affect more than one sector. And so we do have to stand shoulder to shoulder with other groups that can help build this power, that can elevate for our elected officials the issues that are important to us. I was reading a really fascinating article, I think it was in The Atlantic today, about the California waiver. And what that is it's an example in environmental law where California got to set more stringent standards than other places in the country, and other states had the option of adopting them instead of the regular federal standard. And now that's under threat. So you have all of these states that have chosen to protect the quality of their air and chosen to have better standards, and now there is this possibility that Congress is going to come in and say, no way, you can't adopt these standards. And the same could happen with animals. And so we really need to be watchdogs across issue areas and across sectors for opportunities for industry to come in and weaken standards in their favor, because you know they will take it if they can. I would like to say that I don't think we should read too much into the early voting patterns and some of these things that could be seen as a loss in terms of cabinet secretaries or other high-level political appointees
that were successfully appointed. More so than in other administrations, one thing that we've been seeing on the ground is just a lot of chaos. The strategies and tactics and approach of this president and of his administration are just wholly different than even past conservative administrations. He expressed during the campaign an interest in outsourcing policy. You know, I heard the campaign referred to as the first post-policy campaign, it sounds ridiculous, but in some ways there are just, you don't really know who's at the helm when it comes to some of the specific policies, and the confusion that has caused on the ground is massive. There's also this question of who is the 2018 voter? People don't even know who the 2016 voter was yet, because it looks so, it's funny, but I'm dead serious. The number, you know, I used to work on political campaigns and I worked on the Hill, and there's a big numbers game that, if you're a nerd like I am, is really interesting. You know, you dig into the metrics, you look at the polls and the crosstabs and figure out who voted and who was going to vote. And when those numbers are wrong, well, everybody that works in media is really glad for digital media, where you don't have to change the, you know, pull things off the presses, because you have these big surprises, right? And so there's just a lot of figuring things out that's happening right now. And what we can do as the advocacy community is use this time to build power. Look across the issue areas, look across the sectors, highlight for leadership. And Paul's absolutely right. You have a really wonderful opportunity here in the state of New York, because my leader in the Democrats, as an individual, not an RDC, is your senator. And so it is your job to call, and it is your job to elevate these issues. But there are a couple of things in terms of what to look out for that I do want to highlight. Themes that we've seen, particularly at EPA, things that I think we are going to continue to see, and things that it might be easy for the administration to hide. And so it's our job to make sure that we shine sunlight on these things and decomplicate, you know, make things as straightforward as possible, call a spade a spade. And law enforcement is a really big one. You know, as animal advocates, and I think I said this earlier, we have not always been able to rely on robust enforcement, particularly at factory farms, from the federal government. But I don't want to downplay the role that EPA can play. You know, when citizens have complaints, when they notice something is going on, when undercover investigations reveal that there are illegal practices happening at factory farms, EPA has always been a backstop. And now, as I mentioned earlier, we have someone at the helm who has a history of totally destroying enforcement at that agency. And we've started to hear rumblings of what the EPA budget might look like. The administration wants to slash the budget by 25%. Administrator Pruitt has said he wants to preserve certain programs that are state grants. So what that means is, if you look at what's left of the pie after the part he's said that he wants to preserve, you've got to take a really large chunk out of that to get to 25%. And what's left there? Well, enforcement's part of it. And we need to make sure that there is a strong federal backstop to enforcing laws that are meant to capture industrial animal agriculture, like the Clean Water Act, like other laws that can be used and can be pushed by organizations like ours to increase accountability of the big agribusiness companies that are really calling the shots at industrial animal agriculture. And that just isn't possible if there are no staff at EPA, if the staff that are there don't have computers and pencils. I mean, this is the stuff that we're talking about here. We have to make sure that we stay vigilant about knowing how extreme, how far outside the mainstream, how far outside of anything that any past Republican administration has tried, this attack on these systems are. The last thing I think we need to be, there are more, last thing I'll mention that I think we need to be on the lookout for are special carve-outs for industry. And again, it's our job to elevate these above the noise, because there is a lot of noise. So when we see a specific bill introduced that attacks a bedrock environmental law by writing the animal agriculture industry out of it, or a rule introduced, or a rule proposed at an agency that would provide an exemption, we really need to call that out for what it is. which is just a special favor to an industry that is powerful because they have money. And that's not how we do things, and we need to make sure that it stays that way. So it's our job to be on the lookout for that, call that out plain and clear, and not to get discouraged by the chaos that has ensued in these early days of the administration, because it's going to shake out, and there's going to be a better opportunity for accountability as things start to normalize again, and we start to know what happened and have a better sense of what's going to happen next.
I have so many questions I want to ask you, but I will hold them. And it's very, I consider myself an optimist, and I am not optimistic these days. So it's fascinating to hear your perspective, and I can't wait to get to the questions. Thanks, Valerie. Adam?
Okay. So some of this continues with from what I mentioned in the presentation, in the opening presentation. The meat industry does not want to give up the potential benefits of TPP. The big apple in their eye is Japan. Japan was the far and away the third largest economy on the planet, and the big protected market that agribusiness wants access to. The National Pork Producers Council and the National Cattlemen's Beef Association have jointly written to President Trump, calling on him to open bilateral trade negotiations with Japan. That hasn't happened yet. There's not a timeline for it, but there does seem to be interest in that on the part of the Trump administration. The Wilbur Ross, the U.S. Commerce Secretary, who under the Trump administration unusually is being placed at the head of trade negotiations. That's normally the U.S. Trade Representative. Trump flipped things a little by putting the Commerce Secretary in charge, and he has said that his priorities are China, Japan, NAFTA, U.S. manufacturing, and the U.K. So, and why the U.K.? Well, the U.S., I didn't mention it in the presentation, but President Obama was actually, in addition to the Trans-Pacific Partnership, also pursuing a trade agreement with the European Union called the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. While the U.S. has not outright pulled out of that agreement, there's a sense that the term that you keep hearing for it over and over again is that it's in the freezer, that it's basically been put on hold, and that maybe down the line Trump will revive it, but no one really expects that because he just generally seems uninterested in trade agreements with more than one country. So, however, since now on the Trump administration has actually approached individual European countries to put out feelers about bilateral trade deals and has been rebuffed down the line because that's not how, I mean, the European Union is a common trading bloc, and the European Union countries don't pass individual trade agreements with other countries. But there's Brexit. Since the UK is leaving the European Union, and since the UK is in fact the US's largest market, or currently the largest market in the European Union, that is a real possibility for the US. And what does that mean in terms of agriculture? Well, the European Union and European countries have different and higher regulatory standards than the U.S. does. They use something called the precautionary principle. We use this euphemistic thing called science-based standards, which does not mean what it sounds like at all. It means insert industry fake science here, essentially. Europe actually has the idea that you shouldn't find out after the fact that something is bad for you. Imagine that. Throughout the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership negotiations, the meat industry really wanted to crack the European market by knocking down some of those European standards to increase market access for U.S. agribusiness exports. And they were quite explicit that one of the things that they did not want to see in the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership was any kind of animal welfare rule. And in fact, they wanted to use the agreement to bypass some of Europe's animal welfare rules. And get into that and you know, what it's they don't care what Europe does at home, but they shouldn't. But as so long as they're not a barrier to U.S. products entering the market, food safety standards, animal welfare standards. The U.S. has repeatedly sued Europe for having higher food safety standards. For example, when Europe did not like the idea of us compensating for filthy factory farms by washing poultry in chlorine. The U.S. brought a case at the World Trade Organization against the EU's ban on chlorine-treated poultry. So the Transatlantic Trade Investment Partnership was seen as a way in one fell swoop to knock down all those higher European standards as they apply to U.S. products. And so the U.S.-UK free trade agreement could be a way to apply that in a smaller piece just to the U.K., and given the government currently in charge in the U.K., there are real chances that something like that could happen. The U.S. is also potentially pursuing trade agreements with bilateral trade agreements with some of the other member countries of TPP. On the environmental front, the Trump administration has not announced that they're pulling out of the trade in services agreement, which is a super secretive, highly sinister trade agreement of over 50 countries that applies a really broad definition to what can be considered a service. And even breaks down things that you would consider, well, no, that's goods, but like all the services applied to producing that good. So they're going to be using it to do all kinds of things like deregulating the fossil fuel industry. We don't know that the Trump administration is planning on pursuing that agreement. They haven't made it a frontline priority, but what line of work is Donald Trump in? Hotels or service? So something to think about. Beyond that, the big and front and center trade negotiating priority is NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement. Trump has lambasted NAFTA for years and years, correctly. It is a terrible agreement. He's right about that. Fortunately and unfortunately, the meat industry is very worried that Trump's push to bring back manufacturing jobs and get tough on Mexico through NAFTA could lead to a renegotiation where Mexico is less compliant with lowering agricultural tariffs, and that a replacement NAFTA could not be necessarily as favorable to U.S. corporate agribusiness interests. Interestingly, there's a split here between big ag on the one hand and the family farm groups who and food justice groups who say that, you know, market access isn't all we should care about in trade agreements, and countries having the right to make their own food rules is actually a good thing. Small farms don't really benefit from these global export markets don't benefit family farms. In fact, in many ways, they hurt them because they are now competing with cheap imports. So there are people in the farming community who would end up on our side on this issue. In terms of Canada still does have a high level of protection. Canada maintained a high level of protection for its agriculture in NAFTA, particularly for dairy, also for poultry and eggs. So the meat industry is hoping to use a NAFTA renegotiation to increase U.S. Market access and knock down some of Canada's protections for its domestic agriculture. One final point, the border wall. Trump's horrible, racist, stupid border wall, which...
How do you really feel, Adam?
Yeah, right? which we should be aware is not an original Trump idea. This is a continuation of an ongoing effort to blockade that border. I mean, fencing has been going up for years on that border. It is it has caused untold suffering. It is also devastating to wildlife. It disrupts wildlife migratory patterns. And Trump's focus on this wall just speaks to the narrowness and ignorance of his America First economic nationalist focus. Because if we really understand the basis of Mexican migration, it has everything to do with NAFTA. It has everything to do with agriculture. The agreement that he says is such a disaster is the cause of the problem that he is decrying, Under NAFTA, tariffs were eliminated on U.S. agribusiness exports. the corn industry, the dairy industry, the pork industry, flooded the Mexican market. 1.5 million Mexican farmers lost their jobs. While the U.S. maintained their agriculture subsidies, Mexico was forced to eliminate their subsidies for tortillas. Collective farms, the ejido system, was forcibly privatized. Basically, the Mexican rural communities were wiped out in the place of local farms, because now feed grain could enter Mexico tariff-free. The only farming that could survive in Mexico was concentrated industrial farming to compete with U.S. agribusiness. Additionally, U.S. agribusiness now had a great win-win situation where they could send grain south of the border, could set up factory farms in Mexico, use low-wage labor, enjoy lower regulatory conditions, and then export pork back to the U.S. tariff-free. That, by the way, is quite possibly how we got swine flu. A Smithfield Foods ranch in Veracruz, Mexico, called Carroll Ranches.
Wrap up. Okay. I'm going to try to make a bridge to the next section.
Got it. Sorry.
It's okay.
With Mexican agriculture destroyed, with all those industrial jobs that we were told that went south of the border not staying there and ultimately going to China when Clinton did permanent normalization of trade relations with China, Mexicans were left in a country without jobs and with no ways to feed their family. So Mexicans crossed the border for survival, and conveniently were employed by the same agribusiness corporations in factory farms and fields that destroyed the economy of their country. So I'll wrap up there.
Forgive me if I fumble around a little bit here. I'm a little overwhelmed. We want to leave this room charged up and determined, but we've got a president who doesn't read. I mean, you called him, what did you call him? You said,
it wasn't my line, but on the radio I heard him referred to as a post-policy.
A post-policy president.
It's not okay, my opinion,
so he's,
but it's...
So, right, I would be happy with a president who read. And
he reads Breitbart.
He reads Breitbart. So this is so beyond the pale of anything we could possibly have dreamt of, right? And yet, Valerie, you in particular, and Paul, you on the phone the other night as well, were saying Valerie, this is all going to shake out. I'm interested in your optimism and where that's coming from, because I see them, perhaps the puppets who are manipulating him, perhaps intentionally creating that chaos to distract us.
Yeah.
So here's my feeble attempt at a bridge to the next section, which is Q&A, because we want to include all of you quickly. Where's the optimism coming from?
Well, this may not be the answer that you're looking for, but it's thin and fleeting. But, I'm sorry?
We'll take it.
Yeah, it's thin and fleeting, and it's more of a very active wait and see at this point. I think it's extremely important to recognize that what is going on is likely doing lasting and permanent damage to animal welfare and to the other issues that I care about, to the environment and to other many, many, many more issues that I'm probably not the only one in this room who cares about. And so it's extremely important to recognize that, but it's also extremely important not to give into it. And to remember, and when I said shake out, I think there's, how do I put this? There's a few things. When I say shakeout, I don't mean we're going to wake up in a few weeks or months having lived our lives, business as usual, and everything will just be fine. And many of us may, but as a society, I'm not saying that's how it's going to happen. But there is a lot of chaos. I do think a lot of it's intentionally created. And we don't, if you think of it as like a board game or a chess game, we don't quite know what the board looks like right now. And so now is the time to be organizing. But to remember, you know, the odds that we have faced as animal advocates, that others have faced in these incredibly long fights, and to take the long view, I think is really important. And to make sure that not only do we see this as a chaotic and devastating blip, but that we do everything that we can to make sure that it's a blip, that we address as a country some of the causes, and this is so far beyond what I think I'm any sort of expert in, but that we address some of the causes of what created this and, you know, just keep moving. So, not the full optimism.
Absolutely.
But
we'll take it.
But
again,
I think it's our job to make it that way.
Okay. Nice. Thank you for that. Anything you guys want to add before we move to the Q&A?
Yes.
Okay. I have figured, Paul.
Well,
can I just remind you of what you said to me on the phone? We are still a democracy.
Yes. So, I mean, first, actually, to accent that, Kathy, that, you know, I mean, some people are like, oh, this is like 1930s Germany, and it's not like that. I mean, we have far stronger and longer lasting democratic institutions in the United States than Germany did in the 1930s. Like, we're not at that level. At the same time, we're at a very bad level. And, you know, not meeting the Nazi level is not like, it's not, you know, we're not getting there yet. But here's the thing.
Where we set the bar.
Yeah. Noise matters. Just look for example, when the USDA took the data from the website, they took it all down. Outrage started ensuing, and within days, documents started going back up online. Now, they're not all back up yet, but you had HSUS sue them, you had other animal groups later file a lawsuit, you had lots of pressure coming in. You now have a bill that's been introduced in the Congress by Senator Wyden from Oregon to demand they put it all back up. Noise matters. Those documents are now back up, at least in part. We need them all. We're not going to be quiet till they're all back, but noise matters. So there's no point in having a sense, oh, resistance is futile. Quite the opposite. Look what happened to Andy Puzder. People thought that he was definitely going to get confirmed to be our new labor secretary, and now he's back looking for jobs in the private sector. Noise matters, and we can make a difference. We just have to be organized and make our voices collectively heard in the same way that NRA does, in the same way the agribusiness community does, in the same way the labor field does. Animals need that same voice, and we need to let lawmakers know that if they side with animals, they'll be rewarded, and if they go against animals, that they will be punished. Too many of these lawmakers think that animals may be important to some of their constituents, but it's not a top of mind voting. They're not going to go into the voting booth and pull the lever one way or the other based on what their scorecard vote is with the Humane Society. And we need to show them that that is not true, that many animal protectionists are either single issue voters, or at least animals are at the top of the issues on which they're voting. So that's number one. Number two, The forces that are lined up against animals in many ways control the Congress and the administration. They control many of the state legislatures, but they do not control the city and county councils, which are oftentimes dominated by people who would agree with us. So if you are an HSUS district leader or state council member, please raise your hand. All right, you see these hands that are raised here? First, give them a round of applause, then I'll tell you why you're applauding them. These are some of the highest level HSUS volunteers who are working on campaigns in their congressional districts. One, to make sure that animal advocates are getting their voices into their member of Congress and to their two senators. But two, also working at the local level. How many of you know, for example, let me back up. How many of you will remember where you were when Ringling Brothers announced that they were retiring their elephants? All right, a lot of us in the room remember where it was. One of those moments, you'll never forget it. And when they interviewed Ken Feld, the CEO of Feld Entertainment, which owned Ringling Brothers, about why they were getting rid of their elephants, you know what he said? It wasn't any act of Congress. There was no executive order. He said that the local ordinances were too cumbersome that were regulating the use of elephants in circuses. And at that time, it wasn't that many. It was LA, San Francisco, or excuse me, not San Francisco, Oakland, Minneapolis. It wasn't that many. And that was enough to affect the behavior of a multi-billion dollar corporation. Now think about Pepsi. I read just 2 months ago that Pepsi, one of the biggest food manufacturers on earth, is reformulating its soda to have less sugar. Huge public health victory, huge. And why do they do it? because five cities or counties implemented soda taxes of 1 cent per fluid ounce, a minuscule amount of money, and yet local ordinances affected the behavior of this huge company. So if you want to make a difference, think, yes, what can we do to prevent bad things from happening in the Congress, but what can we do to affect good things happening in your city or county council? Now, how many of you are aware that there is a pending ordinance here in New York City right now to ban all wild animal acts and circuses? All right. Now, Joyce, keep your hand up. You want to talk to Joyce, my good friend Joyce Freeman, district leader here in New York for HSUS. And if you want to get active on that campaign, please go see Joyce. There's no reason for you to sit around feeling like there's nothing that you can do. There is something right here, right now that you can do. Hmm. The mayor endorses this legislation. He says if it gets to his desk, he'll sign it. And so all we need to do is get 26 members of the city council to say that they'll support it too. And so I would love it. Please find Joyce at the end of this and talk to her about what you can do to help enact that ordinance. Think about what type of a message that would send the largest city in America saying that you cannot use any exotic animals, not just elephants, but any exotic animals in circuses. You have an opportunity to make a real difference for animals right here, right now in New York City. And the final thing I'll mention is this. You're probably, if you are interested in starting a business that could help animals, this might be the most deregulated opportunity you'd ever have to do it. And so if you want to start a company that's making plant-based meats that can outcompete the chicken companies, or you want to start a company that's making clean or cultured or so-called lab-grown meats, this is the time to do it. There's lots of investors out there. You can make a difference in that space too. And there's nothing that the administration is going to do probably to hinder your ability to do that. So please don't leave this feeling in the sense that resistance is futile. Quite the opposite. The threats that animals face are enormous. There's no sugarcoating it. There are barbarities that are of a magnitude that is almost unfathomable that we need to fight. But there are real opportunities, not just to fight to prevent bad things from happening, but to fight to make good things happen for animals too. Thank you.
So get in touch with your local district leaders, many of whom are in the room, HSUS district leaders. This is a good time. I was speaking, interestingly, with a couple people who, before the panel started, who are really this far away from making a profound life change. So there you go. Maybe this really is the time to do it. What's your number one takeaway? Number two takeaway? What's going to help us leave here feeling empowered and good and strong and resolute and like there is something specific for us to do when we wake up tomorrow, Valerie or Adam?
I'm gonna go ahead and say it. Dig a little deeper in your pockets. That's one thing that we can all do. You know, there are those of us that are fighting this fight every day, and whether it's NRDC or one of the other organizations or one of the other many, many organizations that are fighting this good fight, resources matter. And then it's not the sexiest, but keep calling, keep writing, and keep your energy up doing it. You know, I've been talking about it, like when this administration hit, first it was the sprint, and then we all realized we were running the marathon, and now it's just part of our daily grind. And there was no pause in between, and I'm sure you all feel the same way, and that says nothing of the grieving, right? So do what you need to do to make sure that when other people get distracted by something else, that you are still calling. I've been up on the Hill lobbying, and those phones have been ringing off the hook. I just want to give every single, you know, staff assistant answering them a hug. Like, it's out of control, and that is what we need to keep doing. So whatever you need to do, you know, form a group of people that do this together or do, you know, whatever it is, it's these same tactics. We know what works. We know what builds power. And
that was Michael Moore's
suggestion. What you need to do.
Find your five people.
Find your five people.
Yeah.
So, yeah, and I do think there actually are some real opportunities. President Obama, throughout his administration, really continued the same, fundamentally the same trade agenda of both Bushes and President Clinton, what's called the Washington Consensus, the neoliberal trade agenda, opening markets, deregulation, and by the time of his presidency, spent his term really out of step with his own party. Out of step with congressional Democrats who were answering to the labor movement, to the environmental movement, to food justice and health justice activists. activists who were telling them that these trade agreements are undermining all their work. Now we're in a strange situation where...
Make us feel good, Adam.
Oh, I'm getting there.
Feel good.
Where President Trump, as problematical as his trade agenda is really breaking from that agenda. He is not pursuing the, his agenda is fundamentally different. His economic nationalist agenda isn't the standard model of neoliberal globalization, and that means that he may have a hard time getting Republican votes in Congress to push these kind of trade policies. What that means is that just as President Obama had to pass his trade agreements on Republican votes and basically throw his own party under the bus, President Trump, in order to pass trade agreements, is going to have to look for Democratic votes. That gives us leverage because we can go to Democratic members of Congress and insist that they not support trade agreements that increase market access for corporate agribusiness, that give corporations the power to sue governments in international tribunals when they feel like our environmental laws get in the way of their profits. We can actually help shape the agenda by getting Democrats to say to set the conditions under which they will support trade agreements. So there is real work for us to do here right now. We can meet with our members of Congress. We can let them know what our essential trade negotiating objectives are. On the cards that some of you signed earlier, and for any of you that didn't, please sign them on the way out, you can get a sense of some of what our organization thinks are some of the baselines for bright lines after which we wouldn't allow any member of Congress to support any trade agreements. There are other social movements doing exactly the same thing, many of them working in tandem. There's a real opportunity to align with labor rights activists, with environmental activists, with food justice activists, and work in tandem towards a common agenda that protects public interest regulation, that says that trade policy should not just be about expanding corporate profit, that we should have the right to make laws that reflect our interests, that protect the environment, that protect animals, that protect workers' rights. Our organization, for anyone who wants to do that work, our organization, we're tiny, we need lots of help, we're happy to talk to you. We already are doing that coalition work. We work locally, both locally and nationally, with a broad spectrum of social movements in solidarity, fighting against these trade agreements. And we can help you plug into that work. We can also help you organize in your own local community. If you want to do a screening, if you want to bring a speaker to a community center, organize a town hall, and invite your member of Congress, we can help you do all of that work. We need to start doing the educational work on now to let people realize the stakes, both the opportunities and the potential threat posed by the continuation of trade agreements for corporate agribusiness and the 1%. Two final points. This is a critical moment where it is absolutely necessary for us to work to build respectful alliances with other movements, with the trade justice movement, with the food justice movement, in the fight against the border wall. And I would just say, when doing that, let's remember to show solidarity for other movements, not just go to other groups' events and use it as an opportunity to pass out vegan brochures, but actually be there to support other people's work. That's how we build trust, that's how we build relationships, and that's how we build lasting unity in the fight to make another world possible than the one run by corporations. Thanks.
Yahoo! Some of my notes. This is a chess game. Take the long view. Noise matters. That's a big one. Noise matters. Build alliances. Let lawmakers know. Let lawmakers know that if they decide with animals, they will be rewarded. If not, then they will be punished. Find your HSUS peeps. Quit your job and work for animals. Give to charities. Call and write and call and write and call and write and don't stop. Go to the Democrats and get them to set the terms for the trade agreements. Align with activists and other sectors. Speak to Ada about coming to your organization. This is a good list. Last but not least, we still need to hold on to the joy. Come to Catskill Animal Sanctuary and kiss a pig. got to take care of ourselves as well. Okay, questions? In the back.
Just one.
We're going to, actually, we have a wireless mic here, so just hold it like this.
I have a question about the criminalizing of activists, in particular about the ag-gag laws, which, as you know, probably have been constantly reintroduced every year, and then they're generally defeated, but they keep getting reintroduced by various states. What do you expect to happen under the Trump administration? Do you think this will, they will proliferate, or do you think it will just be the same thing, they get introduced and then are defeated? Because these are really serious and horrible laws.
Paul, are you taking that?
I'm happy to, but I'm also happy to defer. All right, so great question. For those who aren't familiar, the groups like HSUS conduct lots of undercover investigations at places of animal abuse. The meat industry's response to these investigations is not to try to prevent the abuse, but rather it is to try to prevent the abuses from being uncovered. And so they have been the purveyors of these ag-gag bills intended to suppress whistleblowing at factory farms. And as the questioner, what was your name? As Joan correctly mentioned, most of the ag-gag bills have never become ag-gag laws. They have a very low passage rate. The vast majority have been killed. A handful have become law. But what we've seen is a real slowdown in the introduction of these bills because they're so often unsuccessful and because they universally generate negative attention for the meat industry. Many in the industry have become smarter about this and have stopped introducing them for the most part. In fact, the National Pork Producers Council did their own analysis of the news coverage of ag-gag bills, and they found that 99% of the stories were negative toward the meat industry. Made me wonder, like, what's the 1% that was good? I never read it. Maybe it was like in meatandpoultry.com or something. I don't know. But I read that too, so I don't know. I didn't see the 1%. But the only ag-gag bill that has any traction right now is in Arkansas, where they recently passed an ag-gag bill out of the House, and now it's in the Senate. HSUS is doing a strong advertising campaign in Arkansas to try to raise the amount of noise on that to prevent them from taking that vote in the Senate in Arkansas. And so if you are friends with any Arkansans, please direct them to our page on that, humanesociety.org/Arkansas. But to answer your question directly, I don't see a lot of that changing because ag-gag is a state-level fight, not federal, and I don't see a big change on that in the new era that we are now in. Yeah, that's accurate.
So I just want to add that, thank you for that question. And you know, we've challenged a couple of these. There are, if they do pass, you can challenge them in court. And so keep an eye out for those fights. And one, I think that I agree with everything Paul said, and I think that in this era, there's a lot of pressure on journalists, and there are problems with journalism and access, but I think there's also an increased awareness of the importance of journalism, and it presents an opportunity for our movement to align with free speech advocates, and this is a perfect issue for that. So on the theme of looking for places to build bridges across issue areas, the low passage rate combined with this general awareness in the public is an opportunity, and we should not hope for more ag-gag laws to be introduced, but when they are, we should take advantage of it.
Thank you. Hi, thank you everybody for your discussions tonight. So my name is Sharon, and I want to specifically, we've been talking about building coalitions between the different organizations. My question is, there is another really exciting thing happening. There's a soft launch this month of a new organization here in New York called Empire State Humane Voters. It is a 501c4. And so it's unique in that it is the only animal advocacy group that will be exclusively focused on political advocacy for animals in New York on a state level and also on the city level. So what I was hoping the panel might be able to discuss, and I invite everybody, it's very exciting. A lot of elected officials are already excited about working with the group, and ESHV is going to be co-sponsoring Humane Lobby Day with the HSUS in Albany on May 31st. So hopefully everybody get on a bus or carpool. I'm wondering if the panel could talk about, because we're talking about politics now, the not only coalitions between nonprofits, but for those who aren't aware of the distinction between C3s and C4s, how possibly working together we can complement each other, where you can do things we can't do, or a C4 can do things that, you know, vice versa. So how that symbiotic relationship, how that can work, how you envision that happening, and especially the upcoming years. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon, and it's great to see you here. Sharon is a wonderful animal advocate and friend of mine as well. I'm so glad that you're here. Let me just be very blunt. It's not enough to be right. If being right were sufficient, animals would have won long ago. And one of the big problems with the animal movement is that we believe that being right is sufficient. It's not. Animals need us not just to be right. They need us to be both right and effective. And part of being effective in our political system is being able to endorse and oppose candidates and to be able to give money to candidates. There's no getting around it. You may not like that, but it is the cards that we are dealt. And 501c3s, charities that you get a tax write-off when you make a donation to, like the Humane Society of the United States and like NRDC, cannot endorse a candidate. They cannot tell you to vote for or against a candidate, and they certainly can't give a candidate money. But a 501c4 can. And you're not going to get a tax write-off by giving them money, but you can give them money still. You just won't get any benefit to you financially from it, but you'll know psychologically that you're doing a really good thing for animals. And when you have an effective C4 that can disseminate money to candidates, both at the city and state level, all of a sudden, those candidates start taking these issues a lot more seriously, because these candidates are basically fundraisers. Even when they're no longer candidates and when they're in office, they are fundraisers, and money makes the system go round. I won't say her name, but there's one person in LA who is the most responsible for getting the city ordinance that led to Ringling Brothers' retirement of the elephants. And she, over a 2.5-year period, disseminated about $30,000 of her own dollars to candidates in the city council level. And that basically ensured that she had all their ears, that they knew, even if she didn't give them money, that she was somebody who does, and that enabled her to have that access. And it's one of the real reasons why, even though Ringling Brothers came in to lobby against it, that she was able to prevail with the animal advocates. It wasn't the force of the moral argument that was certainly important, but it was also knowing that there were political advantages to doing the right thing. And so again, we have to make it clear to candidates that yes, there's reward and there's punishment, both in the voting box, but also on the political contribution side and on endorsements for who people are going to look to when they're going to vote. And that's what a C4 can be really useful with.
Yeah, interesting. You guys want to add anything, Adam or Valerie? Okay.
Hi, my name's Adelia. States' rights have always been a cornerstone of conservative ideology. With things like the King Amendment and other attempts to curb states' animal welfare standards, do you think that purity still exists, that you could peel people off, or do they slaughter that sacred cow once they're in power?
I think that the states' rights argument is really important when it comes to the safeguards discussion. There, I think you're right that there can be a certain hypocrisy. States' rights, I mean, I live in Washington, D.C. We don't have voting representation in Congress, and there's a congressman who's a conservative congressman who's championed that. I mean, there's not ideological consistency pretty much anywhere. But a talk, as I was saying before, in terms of opportunities to align ourselves with non-traditional bedfellows or strange bedfellows, non-traditional allies, I think that presents one. And so when there is a state that wants to go farther than the federal requirement for a safeguard, we mobilize. There are attorneys general at the state level that do tremendous enforcement work for animal rights, for environmental protection and safeguards, for public health. And, you know, if you have one of them, and if you want to encourage them to go farther with enforcement, to make their voices heard in Congress, when you're contacting your members of Congress, talk about that. If you are represented, probably few people here are, but if you're represented by a conservative member that talks about states' rights, then talk to them about the importance of states being able to be the laboratories for these safeguards and set more stringent standards. So, no, you're not going to find the ideological consistency that everybody talks about having almost anywhere once you peel back the layers, but it is an opportunity.
I totally agree with Val, and we'll just add briefly, these folks like Steve King say that they are for states' rights until a state does something they dislike.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, there's no purity on it. It's not an ideology of some governing principle. Their principle is no regulation. And the reality is that for the most part, the federal government has come in with standards, and these folks who don't want any standards, the states will say, hey, we shouldn't be forced to this. We should be able to do what we want. But if a state tries to have a standard, all of a sudden they're not for it, because again, their principle is no regulation. It has nothing to do with federalism or anything like that. But there are some members of Congress who really are believers in states' rights. Jeff Flake is a perfect example of one of these guys. And they are exactly the type of Republicans who can side on the right side of animals if it works out on that type of thing, like with the King Amendment. They should not be supporting the King Amendment, and they should oppose it on states' rights issues. Steve King is not one of them, but others are.
So, yeah, I just want to say, I mean, in terms of our work, one of our strongest arguments that we've used consistently is that free trade agreements undermine federalism and narrow policy space for state level for state and local elected officials, well, particularly state elected officials in this case, that when a state government wants to, say, pass a buy local rule or a recycled content rule, and that can be undermined by a free trade agreement with another country, basically you have the federal government in collusion with another country limiting what state governments can do. When a state, or in the case of Canada, a province, like Quebec, passes a moratorium on fracking and then faces a lawsuit under the North American Free Trade Agreement, you have a federal government limiting state action. And of course, if that can be done against a Canadian province, that can be done against a U.S. state when the next time a U.S. state decides to pass a moratorium or ban on fracking. So this is a good argument to use with state-level elected officials, and that can be used towards things like state resolutions against free trade agreements, for city council resolutions, and those that in turn can be used to put pressure on our members of Congress, on our senators and representatives, and ultimately, hopefully, on the president. Don't hold your breath on that one, though.
Thank you. This is I was really excited when I saw this conference coming up. I just came back from Duke University, where I was with E.O. Wilson's foundation talking about his concept of half Earth, where we try to put half.
And Bonnie, tell us who you are, because you're a major VIP. Why were you with E.O. Wilson? I said, tell us who you are, because you're a VIP. Why were you with?
I'm Bonnie Wiper, and I run an organization called Thinking Animals. But the point of that was that this huge global effort that they're making to put half of the world aside for biodiversity, the point that they came up with in terms of how to implement it was to get political. And it's absolutely great. But I'd also like to add another point to this. We're a small group here. There's just so much we can do. There's a whole world out there, and if we want to affect change, we have to get out to that world with an argument that in effect makes it in our interest, self-interest, to change. So I'm gonna make a shameless plug for something that we're doing, but we're putting together a conference in May that looks at the consequences to people of their of how they treat other species. And we're looking, we have experts coming in on human health, on global security, environmental sustainability, national economies, and human happiness. And we're discussing what each panel will have someone from animal advocacy, conservation, and the oceans represented. What are the consequences? We're not saying to people, don't do this. We're saying, okay, go ahead and eat your meat or take your trophy hunting home with you. this is the consequence if you do.
Bonnie, what's your website?
Thinkinganimalsunited.org.
Thanks.
Thinking animals. Thank you, Bonnie.
United.org. Thanks.
As an individual, I look at social media and I see the post about the Humane Society, and I thank you for all the work that you do.
You can stop there. I know there's a butt coming there.
What I found concerning was when you used the word refuge, you know, for the United States, that's going to be attacked by, you know, others for to make money or for the trade. But, you know, I want to make noise. I want to be one who helps to make noise on this particular issue because the word refuge, obviously, our president is supposed to be determined by a definition and left alone. So how do we go about, you know, stopping that and the domino effect that it would come if it was successful?
Well, there's a whole network of federally managed lands that have various types of protections. A refuge is a legal definition of one that sadly does not mean you can't go hunt on them. But there's monuments, there's refuges, there's a whole host of other federally managed lands throughout the country that have this. And sure, I totally agree. The common sense definition of refuge should be that animals ought not be slaughtered within them. Sadly, that's not the case. But one of the best things that the Obama administration did was on the way out, they created a new monument off the Atlantic coast that prevents commercial fishing in a huge swath off of the Atlantic coast. And that really would just basically cease commercial activity out there for the most part. And the fishing industry just this week filed a lawsuit, they sent a letter to Trump asking him to reverse that declaration of the monument. In fact, I think there is a lawsuit on it challenging Obama's use of the Antiquities Act to do that. I think I'm not conflating that with something else. But anyway, they're not happy with it. And so those are the type of things that, yes, we can be speaking out against to ensure that that new monument is not touched. But overall, we want more land protected, and we want the highest designation because, as Bonnie correctly pointed out, you know, E.O. Wilson, who's a real hero of mine, if you've not read his stuff, I highly recommend it. You know, he makes this point that we ought to be putting aside more of the earth to be basically for wildlife. If you look at areas where humans aren't, like the demilitarized zone that separates North Korea from South Korea, or Chernobyl, where people haven't been allowed to live, these are basically wildlife paradises now with some of the greatest levels of biodiversity on earth. And just mere human presence alone is really damaging for wildlife's ability to thrive. And so we need to designate more of these places off limits, especially for commercial activity, and maybe even more. But that is the type of designation we ought to really be seeking for more and more land. And so if you haven't read Half Earth, highly recommend it. Check it out. It's a really good one. Or The World Without Us, another great book by Alan Weissman, a really good, interesting look at what happens in places where humans aren't.
No relation.
Well, one of them is a highly restricted military zone that goes 151 miles along the border. Yeah.
Did you petition Congress to set up a demilitarized?
Yes, we're not.
You could petition them. Yeah. Probably wouldn't work.
Just a footnote about, and this is from memory, so anyone correct me if I'm wrong if I'm misremembering this, but if memory serves, the way that wildlife refuges were opened to hunting was as a compromise with the hunting lobby in the fight over the passage of the Endangered Species Act. That was what the hunters demanded, to not oppose the Endangered Species Act. So when you hear from recreational hunters about how they're the true conservationists, that's something you may want to point out.
Media, we're just inundated with people saying, sign this, write to this person, come to this event. for education, for women's issues, for racial issues, for criminal justice. There's just nonstop onslaught of things to be worried about. And if we want to make this topic of animal welfare, you know, something that we can work on, have you guys come up with strategies how to incorporate that into the other issues? You started to touch on it, Adam, when you were saying that farmers are going to be losing work because of the lowering regulations. So this could be a jobs issue, or thinking about health for, you know, established health issues for the Affordable Care Act. Like, mm-hmm. have you started thinking about the ways that you could strategically tie our questions and our, you know, worries to other things that people could be working on, so that we don't suffer from fatigue of having to do 20 things a week?
And so that we're ultimately more effective together.
Right. And working
perhaps.
With other people.
Yeah.
So there are, I think there are a few questions in there, and one is just about general compassion fatigue, which I think is if for anyone who's not heard the term, it is a thing. Probably a high number of people in the room are experiencing it. I know I personally find it really challenging to read about animal abuse every day. And, you know, in my first year or two of practice, I found myself having more in common with other, you know, disciplines from law school my friends in other disciplines that traditionally experience compassion fatigue than I would have necessarily expected. And so there's the, if I put my like general public interest lawyer hat on, there's the self-care element. And that's what I was talking about at the beginning when I said, make sure you can keep going, that you don't burn out, that when the noise that is so important starts to die down across the board, if that happens, and I'm not making a prediction that it will, but that you are able to move forward. And there aren't easy answers for that, but I think that's something we're all struggling with. In terms of looking across issues, you know, this is something that I deal with every day. When I was joking at the very beginning about all of the nouns involved in describing what I do, animal welfare trust, health, food, environment, you know, there are all of these disciplines. And I think Paul hit on something when it's not just about being right, it's about being effective. You don't always, you should always tell the truth, and you should always have an earnest strategy, but that doesn't always mean you have to explain to every single person you meet every single motivation for that strategy that you have. And so, you know, for example, we work on a lot of issues around antibiotics on industrial animal agriculture facilities. And the overuse and misuse of antibiotics can lead to a lot of really horrendous practices, really filthy conditions, and lower welfare for animals. Every single person that cares about every effect of antibiotics doesn't necessarily get motivated by animal welfare, or doesn't necessarily get motivated by the devastating public health effects on nearby communities. It's about knowing your audience and highlighting the one or two things that are most important to them that you can really say with facts and that are true about whatever issue that you're working on. And it's challenging and it's hard, and you're switching. You have this huge reservoir of facts, and you're trying to find the one that's going to resonate most with your audience. But that's the kind of toolkit that these times demand. And so there is a lot of work like that going on. You know, the antibiotics issue, I think, is a great one because it touches on animal welfare, public health, community health, environmental justice. Spans the issues. But there are others that are like that. And so we just have to find them and cultivate it.
The former slave and great American orator, Frederick Douglass, said famously that I will work with anyone to do right and no one to do wrong. And that's what I think about when we think about what can we do to actually do right in the world. And so Adam is very right that, you know, these hunters were very concerned about being able to shoot animals in wildlife refuges, and now including with lead ammo. But many of them oppose, for example, fossil fuel extraction from federally managed lands because it destroys wildlife habitat. And so I'd be quite happy to work with the hunting lobby to prevent fossil fuel extraction from federally managed lands and leave it. I would much rather there be wildlife habitat and have some of them be killed by hunters than to be totally decimated by oil drilling, for example. And so That would be one example of a strange bedfellows, for example, but other times it need not even be strange. I mean, needless to say, animals and the environment oftentimes go hand in hand, so environmental groups and animal groups ought to be doing, ought to be working together. As Val correctly pointed out, the public health community often is, or should be at least, in lockstep alignment with us on factory farming issues. So I think there's a lot of ways to build alliances that we can make ourselves and animals, therefore, more powerful. And I just don't want to see animals get subsumed in the process where they take the back seat. Animals take the back seat in virtually every transaction in our society. And when we form these alliances, animals should be in an equal partnership with our new friends rather than just a second thought in the back.
Yes, sir. Thank you for that.
Is it too late to ask everyone to silence their phone?
I know. I forgot I was using it as a stopwatch. Darn it.
So,
I'm not embarrassed.
So, for those of us doing in the trade justice movement, I mean, the thing that we contend with is kind of the bad guys do that thing. They form big coalitions of all the different corporations from all the different industries coming together to pass a trade agreement. So there's, for example, the U.S. Business Coalition for TPP. So pretty much by obligation, we've always had that. I mean, that model has been the only way that we've been able to fight. When you have a confluence of forces that is that huge and that powerful aligned against you, you better have some friends. You know, it has never been lost on us that as animal advocates, we alone could never win one of these fights. There is no way that the scope of our influence is going to overpower the industries that are aligned against us on this. What we've seen time and again is that when people come together around a common interest, we actually do have power. I'm of a generation where, you know, just a few years into my activist life, I was deeply inspired by what people call the Battle of Seattle, where social movements converged on Seattle at the Millennium Round of the World Trade Organization and basically shut down this meeting until it fell apart, until there was so much internal pressure based on the protests happening outside that the World Trade Organization kind of ground to a halt and took the better part, and pretty much has been struggling to proceed with negotiations really ever since. They finally just added a new agreement the other day. But it was really a significant blow. Social movements coming together stopped the multilateral agreement on investment, stopped the free trade area of the Americas. In Germany, in Europe, even before anything Trump did, Europe basically killed the transatlantic trade and investment partnership by things like protests of 250,000 people in Berlin. And that was, really the way this happened was by speaking to the fundamental issues that brought people together, by asking, who makes the decisions? Who really is going to run our world? Is it all of us? Whether we're concerned, whether we're focused on healthcare issues, whether we're focused on access to medicines, whether we're focused on food issues, whether we're focused on animal issues, whether we're focused on environmental issues or labor issues, or is it going to be politicians working in service to corporations? Who is going to be making the rules?
And on that note, you got to get that last sentence out of me. Say it. Or you got to say it.
Go ahead, because I was at a couple
say
more.
It.
So,
are you really? You sounded like you were had a profound concluding thing to say.
Oh well,
so I'm gonna cut you off.
Okay, I'll jump a few sentences ahead and then pivot, which is and just say that if we as an animal movement want to do this work, if we want to do work with other movements, before we look outside, we have to look inside. We have to address issues in our own movement that are a barrier to working with other movements. We have to look at issues, oppression issues within our own movement, look at issues of racism, sexism, etc. in our own movement, because unless we do, people already don't like working with animal activists, and we're not going to, those doors are not going to be open to us unless we deal with our own shit. So.
Yeah, great point. Thank you very much. You know what? I want to do two things. Okay.
I have one question to ask. Yeah, good evening. My name is Yadu. Wanted to know, why is it not possible to just outlaw the killing and abuse of animals and the production and sale of meat?
Thanks for the question, Yanu. I'm sorry, how do you pronounce it? Yadu, thank you, sorry about that. So thanks for the question, Yadu. Generally, laws are reflective of societal norms, and 99% of Americans are not vegan. And so to the extent that we want to pass laws on that topic, I think we've got a lot more work to do to get society ready. We live in a democracy, which means majority rules, and those policies do not enjoy majority support or even small minority support.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Go ahead. Last question.
This has to do with the issue of refuges. I wonder about fighting against USDA Wildlife Services, which has been massacring approximately 4 million animals every year in this country, many of them from refuges and sanctuaries. Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge is an example where the geese were murdered 50 to 100 or more, several hundred sometimes, every single year. And we've been fighting them and talking out and writing things and doing all the things that have been suggested here, giving money and so on and so on, and nothing makes any dent. I wonder if there's anything else that we might be able to do to fight that organization. And there's so many newspaper articles about them and so on.
Anybody have a quick response?
Very briefly, I am optimistic that may be a program that could get cut. A lot of these agencies, except for DOD, need to cut their budgets because of the Trump plan. And so Wildlife Services is part of USDA. Sadly, it's not a big part of their budget, so cutting it really wouldn't save that much money. But for sure, this is just a handout to agribusinesses that want to slaughter especially predators or other animals like starlings who they view as a nuisance. And so I am optimistic that would be one program that could be cut. I don't know. I think that it's an important question, just like the one previously from Yadu is an important question too. We don't know whether we can do that, but we certainly will try.
Michael, could you quickly come up here with the thing? Okay, very challenging time, which we all know. The vulnerable among us, including but not only the animals, need the very best of us. Be strong, be courageous, take care of yourselves, and come kiss the pigs. I'm going to turn it over to Ray Ippolito for a goodbye. I do want two people to just give you a piece of information before you walk out the door. Our friend Victoria Moran has written something that I think we need to know about, but I just found out about it. Does everybody know who Victoria is? Author, public speaker, Main Street Vegan Academy, a vegan coaching program. She's fabulous.
Wow. If the animals are all safe, you can go into PR. I think we all do what we do, and I'm a writer. So I've written an editorial called Vegan in the Time of Trump, because I actually believe that animals, because everybody says they like them, right, left, wherever, I think that animals might be a way to unite our fractured country. The editorial hasn't yet been published, but I did give a talk on this topic that was a Facebook Live, and if you go to Main Street Vegan on Facebook, you can see it. Thank you.
Main Street Vegan says, and sir, tell us about your book, because we need to read this book, yes. And your name is? I just heard you interviewed.
Gene
I should
Stone.
Remember it.
Gene Stone.
Gene Stone.
Yeah. I also wrote Books Overnight, and I co-wrote How Not to Die, and Living in a Harm Sanctuary Life, and The Engine to Diet.
You've been a busy man. Take it away, Ray. Thank you, you beautiful people. Ray Ippolito.
And I'm actually working with Nathan Munkle on animals, but this book is the Trump Survival Guide. Basically, it's 12 issues, including animal rights, which is in the back of the book, unfortunately, because that's what my publisher demanded. But basically, what I want you to do, if you feel like it, is if you get a copy of the book, find an issue, find something you can do. The point of this book is, as Paul says, noise matters, and I keep saying, do something. And that's the optimistic note. If you do something, something will happen.
Thank you. Thank you. time today?
Yes.
Yeah, it's beautiful, right?
Yeah.
I want to thank our panelists so much. Thank you, Paul. Thank you. Thank Screamers Pizza and support. And we're grateful for your support. Thank you for coming out. We are we're continuing a series this year in the city that we'd love for you to be a part of. Come here to the events, come tell your friends. That'll help if you give us your email address, like I had asked before, right? If you didn't do that, please make sure you do so outside. And whatever you can do to support our efforts, we're really grateful. So many of you are supporters. Whatever you can do to support our these events or anything else is really important, right? We would not be able to bring these great, great minds together had it not been for your support. So we ask for your continued support, right? Every dollar goes to helping the animals and creating events that bring veganism and the lives of animals to the forefront of our culture. So we're really grateful for that. Please come volunteer. Please come to the sanctuary. Kiss a pig. Kiss a goat. We'd love to have you there, please. And I will say one last thing. Everything that we did here, everything that was said here, and especially you, you said this, and it's very important. We can click our way, right? All day clicktivists. We could be great clicktivists, right? It's easy to do. We could have great ideas. We could have great thoughts. But it's extremely important that we are in action. We have to be in action. It's so beautiful, right, to be amongst all of us. Like, we are all, we could have done anything tonight, so all you beautiful people chose to be here to make a difference, to listen, but now we have to take it out and act. So thank you for being here.